in year 1993 from Gujarat Agriculture University. Then he joined private hatchery as a technical manager. In 1995, he started his poultry consultancy services in South Asia. Along with consultancy services, he completed his PhD program. He completed 3 certificate courses at International Grains Program, Kansas State University, and 2 workshops at University of Georgia. During last 22 years, he received appreciation with Young Scientist Scholarship Canada, Hongton Trust Limited Award UK for presenting paper on molecular characterization of pathogens, Young Scientist Fellowship from British Poultry Science Limited UK, Foundation for Promoting Poultry Science Holland, and World Poultry Science Association Canada. As a consultant, he did many research projects on enzymes, growth modeling, pro and prebiotic applications. He is also involved in development of precise enzyme application tool for feed formulation software. Many multinational companies from Europe, Americas, and Asia benefited from technical expertise on applied research projects. Dr. Patel has an active hobby to work on human genetics in collaboration with Geneva Medical School, Switzerland. He is also active member of WPSA, PSA, INFAD, FAO Rome since last 16 years. He is a great example of academic excellence and has applied innovative concepts in the field of nutrition, which has benefited a lot to Indian farming community. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Uday Patel with huge round of
applause. Inspector, senior teachers, including Dr. Anand, who is supposed to be the last teacher in my master's, my senior colleagues like Dr. Ranjit Reddy, S. V. Rama Rao sir, and the full team of Hyderabad, my colleagues of the same age like Dr. Deshpande and others, and our junior professional who are growing very fast. And I really respect them because I interact with them, everybody, being as a consultant and being as a, you know, other jobs where they applied their expertise to support the industry. So welcome you all, and thanks to the VIPNs that they asked me to talk on optimizing the performance of present day layer. It's a so huge topic. I'm not lucky like Dr. Deshpande, where he has to speak only on energy and protein, because in commercial layer, every farm is different. Every farm has a different concern, different objective, maybe within the same region or maybe a different region. It's very different. So let me start something very interesting. This is left and right. In this slide, only one word is very important. I think everybody should know that word since last 1 month, the Tuscany. How many know what is Tuscany? Yeah, see, Viruska, the most senior guy says Viruska. Exactly same, sir. The Leghorn word, the Leghorn, what we call the white Leghorn, the layer bird, is come from there. It's very interesting history. That word is come from that particular word called Livorno. Livorno is an area where the Tuscany town is there. But those Britishers don't speak Italian. They live on, they make it Leghorn. So it's this white Leghorn, which is exported in early 800s to the America, and from America back to the Britain and Europe. And then the multiple genetics company developed that as a white Leghorn and brown Leghorn as a commercial layers. So our present day layers originated from the Tuscany. Let's talk about the position of our industry across the world. And just one slide. If you see from 1971 to the 2011, we grown from almost more than 10 places and reached up to the third place. From 11 to 18, still we are in a third place because the gap between second and third is very huge. But we are growing very fast. Let me show you something. Why we can grow fast? Because we have a potential population who can consume more. We are as poor as Nigerians, but other poor countries like Mexicans eat the highest in the world. That's the irony. Egg is such a beautiful food, but we have a long way to go. And that's why in layer industry, in my experience of 25 years, I never seen that anybody made a loss. I will show you how. Look at the population in 1990s, the performance from there to the 15, all the way from somewhere 5 crore to 24 crore, the huge quantum of jump. Average growth is almost 9 to 10%. If you can see the cost of production from there to here, and the difference, which is a margin for the client, is still maintained at a good level. There is a lot of changes on management factors, we'll discuss later on, but yes, it changed from 1990 to the 15 and 18 in a big way. My friend Sam Bhagat yesterday, I asked him and immediately get me information, dig out the real time, real price, all the way from 1991 to the this year, the 17, we finished this in December. You can see the average egg price, the Pune's neck price, from 75 paisa, now last year average is 3.84 rupees. The average neck price, there may be discount on a sales, which may be allowed like 15, 20 paisa. But you can see how we grown fast. And there is a sudden jumps in a years. And I missed to put a feed price, but I digged out one file, and then I will ask that question to those senior colleagues who started a feed mill, and they need to tell me which year this formula belongs. Sir, my seniors have to tell me, this is the real farmer's formula, and that client is 12 years client, then I left because of bird flu. I have 12 years formulations, and this is not this century's formula. This is 20th century formula. Just guess the year, two year plus minus, no problem, sir. You can see the ingredient price. You can see some product as an indicator. No, little late. We're very close. It's December 1999. Yeah, sir. Yeah, and this formula belongs to one of client in Dhulia called Santosh Poultry. And he was very fond of computers, so I'm so lucky that I communicate on Excel those days, formula after formula, and I maintained 12 years in a single Excel file. So that gave indication that what price we had that time and what egg price we got that time. Those margins are still maintained. There may be a plus and minus, but in a cycle of 5 years, the average margins remain same. So what we have, we had these strains, not now. These strains came and went back and again came and went back. At the moment, we have options of these four major groups. The BV300 is famous, we know. It's now BV330, we call. Bovans is also very famous, as Dr. Anjit handled Bovans 20 years before. So it's so old bird. And then Highline also, so those days came and then went back and again came. And now we are getting the another genetic group, W80. I will tell a little more about them. And then we still have a Lohmann LSL light, which is known for livability across the world. Let me show you some key differences between those strains. And then we talk about the economics and the other concern. If you compare, the livability is almost very good up to 17 weeks between 96 to 98. If you talk about the feed consumption, of course, it depends on the weight gain. So if you see the body weight at 17 week, the lightest is a baby Babcock, and you know that. And the heaviest is, you can say, the W36, or you can say Lohmann. Bovans also a heavy bird, but people maintain it light for economics. So if you go further beyond the pullet and talk about the performance during the laying, you can see on an average, these having almost same peaks. But if you see the number of eggs, they are also same. The most important difference comes when it comes to the days as 50% egg production. This is very important gain in last 30 years. Next slide, I will show you what is the importance of age at 50%. At the moment, across the strains, Babcock is doing best to get that 50% production. That's 135 days as early as that. Otherwise, others are around 140 plus. Another important point in India, still we are selling eggs by number, not by weight. Those strains which are still maintained in European as a pure line or Americans, this work on the egg mass, or you can say egg weight. Whereas our market is egg number. So here, the one strain called Babcock can outperform others by egg weight. And that's the need of the client, because the transport condition, long distance transport, and all those factors for the cell quality and preservability, it's a key factor. Some markets are asking for a big eggs, but it at the cost, because you don't get extra money for that. If you talk about the other body weight, is also most important, as Dr. Deshpande explained about the maintenance requirement, which is the major part, almost like 70% plus. It's the same in layer. And for that, if you're having a bigger bird, it costs you more on a nutrient, means cost of production. In that also, you have to consider what is your market requirement. Is it an egg size or an egg number? Because ultimately, it's a feed efficiency which make you earn. So you can see the big difference between the strains. Even in cell quality, there is a differences are there. On average, if you see the FCR per kilo of egg per kilo of feed, they are almost same. But it's a well-known fact that across the world, Highland is the best converter for the feed, for the kilo of egg. And you can see that they are the only we can claim that they can go below 1.9. So now when they ask me the optimizing the layer performance can optimize only from their pullet stage. So I found that some basic housing requirement I should tell, which plays a very important role. And I'm not going to explain, because most people know what it is. I'll tell exactly the point where people even today make mistakes. One of that is the brooding management. Many people are in cages, but because of the some disease scenario like a CAV and others, many people went back to the deep litter. Dr. Latkar is here, he's doing excellent in a deep litter as a pullet grower. He can make a cage and grow 8,000 breeder to 25,000 breeder capacity like that in a commercial pullet growing business. But he cannot, because he know that if you do that, the average mortality jump by 15%. So that's the advantage of deep litter versus a cage system. Space, you can have EC farm, you can give more space, better ventilation. That may be many options for this brooding management, or you can say pullet management. Another factor, same as a breeder, because in breeder they consider that they must shift it before 16 week. It is very similar in a layer, because the layer bird start eggs almost like 105 days. So they must be shifted before 100 days to adjust them in the cages and maintain the intake during the very crucial phase of ovary and oviduct maintenance. And the last but not least, most people now keep the bird not less than 80 weeks. Many people yesterday I seen 120 weeks. So either they do a straight run up to 80, 90 weeks, or they may do a single cycle or two cycles up to 30 weeks. And if you grow bird for a long age, the big concern is the big growth. If you don't have a particular standardized debicking where the big growth get neutralized for the long period, it will create a big problem. And if you end up in a pecking, or if you end up in having another debicking during laying, it's not advisable. When Santosh asked me to speak in 35 minutes, I say I spent 3 hours with Raju Bhai for his new layer farming design. 3 hours. Now he is a 35 years old layer farmer, right? Even today, there are so many critical points, because it changed with the times and the pollution factors and so many things. So very shortly, I say is that most critical point people make avoid considering the 10 to 15 degree south from east-west, which... So, very important is the the when you plan a layer farm, it cost you maximum when you waste performance during summer, and particularly that is a March, April, and the second is October heat, the September and October. And these are the months when sun moves and come in one position. And if you don't have this shade on a degree from 10 to 15 degree to the south, east-west, the sun rays come on a one particular row. And it's a big cost. It's just a small consideration and you can avoid. There is another example is now the most people having a menace of the maintaining a dry litter. There are multiple factors you can control, but most important is the ventilation at the litter level. People consider now having a height not less than 8 feet from ground to the platform and net not less than 11 to 12 feet from platform to the side of the roof. It's very much required if you are talking about a long term with the big house with the four rows, 50,000 birds. There are many options in a cage design. We have a client in a comfortable climate who give only 45 square inch per bird. And I have seen some clients who are giving a 65 square inch per bird for the big birds like a Lohmann because they grow 1.7. And some birds don't grow more than 1.45. But it's a huge economic advantage. And some people are doing this since many years with the standard 320, 325 plus eggs at 45 square inch per bird. So it depends at what climate you are, what is your management practices, and how efficiently you can manage the birds. How big is the shade? And then there is another consideration in cage for like overlapping the cage, nipple, plus channel, or just nipple and just channel, and maybe the position of nipple. So that's very important, and I will tell that fogger and fence I don't talk because everybody knows about it. But this is what people do now. I seen somewhere in a Karnataka belt, in a Pune belt, that they have both the system. They don't have foggers, though they don't have fans, but they have channels to support birds in the summer, and they have a nipple to use otherwise. But these nipples are in a position that those nipples, if they are leak, or every time bird drink a water, the 10-15% water which drop down goes to the channel. And this really makes your litter very dry. You can just avoid all the expenses for the fly control by just a small modification. There are many examples in Maharashtra, and my colleague consultants and professor and everybody seen that. It's a huge advantage. Anyone, I explain here in Rajahmundry also people doing this now. So what are the goals for optimizing layer performance in a nutshell or as a layer client or as a layer consultant? You want a high peak for a long time. You may have a long laying cycle if you don't want to molt up to 80-85 weeks. You want a better egg size as per your market scenario. You need a good shell quality and of course good skeleton. Means you don't want lameness, you don't want a culling. So first step is that grower and pullet, and this is the most crucial step. If you go through this step very precisely, your layer performance and layer management will be very easy. This is what I said, what changed from 58 to 2009 is that age at sexual maturity, or you can say age at a first egg, or you can say age at a 50% production, it dropped down by 34 days. It's in a wide leg years from 175 days, it comes down to 140 days. So that's the time because those birds who start laying late have enough time to grow skeletal and the body protein reserves and fat reserve. Now they don't have a time, really don't have a time. Most important mistake people are doing, and I will specifically say, Dr. Latkar, please consider this slide. Every time you give a pullets or underweight, we are on a red chart, not on a blue. And that red is really made us suffer. Because you can do a compensatory growth at that age after 15 weeks, but that growth is not protein growth. It's only fat growth. And that don't go to help in a laying stage. What we need is this persistent charge with the standard body frame, which has more protein and more skeletal structure. So we need a strong, round fat. No, we need a tall, lean hen before we start the laying.
Very key points I am talking about in a pulled nutrition quickly. This is the because a major portion up to 16, 18 weeks where we have 50% production. Most important point is body weight uniformity. I talk about some slide on that. There are many feeds you can go through. Depends on your facility available. More you partition, more uniformity you get, more better weight gain you get in an adverse climate. That's why people do those things. And there are always a stress factor like a debaking, shifting, vaccination, adverse climate, which against the growth. And for that, what we can do, let me show you some slide. Most important point now talk about these people. And very recently, just last week I analyzed a flock at the Yojana poultry, which just finished 80 weeks, a straight cycle. And we compare the number of eggs, laying mortality, the start of production at 50% production, and the hen house FCR. Of course, feed per egg, not kilo per kilo. There is a difference of 9 gram at the age of 80 weeks per egg. Only reason we able to find out that we made a trial that we use only the crumbs up to 16 weeks in a flock where we have a 9 gram bad FCR. And the only reason we can scientifically explain that those layer birds never have that strong digestion system and the strong gizzard, what we need. So that's very important part, and that's why we consider mass and grower mass, we grind at 6 MMCU. Those crumb people grind at 2.5 MMCU. You can never have a growth of the gizzard. It's the same for breeder. So this is what I say. There are a strain variation as we talk about 4 strains in a market. There is a strain variation, and that's because of genetics, not because of nutrition. They respond differently on the same diet. So some may grow very fast, like 6 to 8 weeks, 6 to 12 weeks, or 12 to 18 weeks, at the same energy and protein level. But they are as per their genetic potential, and you cannot really do anything. When we talk about the pre-lay diet, it's very important. As we talk about having a 50% production at the age of 20 weeks, which supposed to be previously at 22 weeks. 2 weeks early means you have to have make bird ready for the egg production 2 weeks early. So for that, the common factors people are doing with the grids and the pre-lay diet, you have to manage very nicely. If I put in a chart, this is what a grower and developer, and then you have a 14 days of the free lay where you can have not a sudden high jump on a calcium, 2 to 2.5 gram of calcium, and then you have a first egg. By first egg, you will have a layer mass. So then bird don't have to waste their time to get the calcium. I will tell you what happened. These are the bones. These are the structure bones, and these are the skeletal bones where there is no medullary growth because these birds are before laying. And these are the birds which are laying. Look at the huge difference. The bone grown from nowhere to grow to this place. This is what you need to make before the first egg. If you see 16-week pullet, the bone, if you cut, you can see like this. Either you see a cortical bone or a medullary bone. At first egg, they are like this. You must have these bones to avoid all those lameness during the peak production and sudden drop in a peak production. And at the end, the cell quality. So this is what the medullary bone contribute from 35 to 40% of calcium. But rest, you have to give through the feed. It's not 100% that bone can go back and come out every 24 hours. So these are the key point where you can have that active period from, say, 7 hours in morning to the night, 8 p.m., where there is a lot of feed intake, and then direct calcium absorption to the cell glands. And then roast, the rest period where they can use from the bones. A little bit on layer nutrition. There is a strain variation, but unanimously the nutritionists in practice, they don't do a separate formulation for separate strain. Because in fact, the genetics is such that it's a gram of every nutrient required for a gram of egg, and they are fixed. So I will show you some chart. This is the very famous model which decides you what should be the energy for 100 gram consumption. And it considers those body weight, egg mass, temperature, feather score, and the gain. And this is very important when you consider those grams. You have to consider all the amino acids based on the energy. And before that, you have to consider lysine per energy. So this is what the amino acid balance we recommend in a three phase of pullets, starter, grower, and prelay. And this is what you can use as a nutritional requirement for the various stage, be it any stage, because we just divide and it depends on the intake and the body weight gain. So it should be in a balanced format like this, and all other will take care of it. Similarly for layers, this is what an ideal amino acid ratio to lysine. And this is what the nutrient requirement for 1.35 kg body weight to the 1.45 kg body weight, which is common to us. And this is what the nutrient requirement per day for different body weight and, of course, different egg mass, 59, 57, and 54. Same like breeder, exactly same. If you have less egg mass, your nutrient requirement will be very less, like lysine per day from 0.83 to the 0.85 and 1.45. But if we neglect the pullet nutrition, and if birds is at negative balance either on a protein side or energy side, you will have this issue, because when they come to the peak, there is always lack of appetite. They need a lot of nutrient, but they don't eat because of so many factors, because of the first egg, the first stress, laying stress, or maybe the other stress, and that's why they don't consume. So nutrient density at this stage is very important. If you don't do, the bird will tell you what to do. They dip the production, try to balance the nutrient for the maintenance, and then again come to layer. But by that time, you lose almost 10, 15 eggs of the laying cycle. So this is what the chart I says when energy is required for the egg production. The protein has a major effect on egg size, and the energy is a major effect on egg number. So this is for the egg weight, which is the amino acid and protein, and this is what energy, which is responsible for the egg production. Many of these slides are mainly from Professor Steve Leeson, because from 91 we learn only their book, and later on we are so lucky that he visited us so many times, and those slides are some in 15, 20 years old, and still they are the same. He says there is no change. This also is very old slide, you can find 20 years before, and this is what he says. This is the stage of 33C where you change from positive energy to negative energy because of the intake and excessive energy loss for the maintenance of the body temperature. So most ideally he says 27, 28 where CO maximum, and that's what we try to do by using foggers, fans in adverse climate, or in a cool climate we put a curtains to maintain it. Another important point, because everybody has a heat stress and they don't consume feed in a daytime. We want to give a feed in a night time, but there is the very nice principle explained that the first period should be smaller than the last period before the day start. If you do a reverse way, the production drop will happen. Many people complain that, sir, I follow midnight feeding and production drop. That's just because you are not maintaining the cycle. This is 3 hours, 1 hour feeding, and this should be a 4 hour before the day start again. If it is reverse, the whole light cycle will disturb for a long period. There are many things we are doing for the heat stress management, and you know about everything. I just talk about two slides for the metabolic disease, which is the concern. One is the most important is the FLHS, which is basically because of imbalanced diet. If there is no enough nutrient which control the hunger, including the calcium, sodium, energy, bird may overeat and end up like this. And another big important factor which we explain is the lameness. We call it cage layer fatigue, but the main cause is the pullet management. If you don't develop that skeleton before the first egg, in the laying stage, you will face this problem. And you face this for a long time. some common diseases, because there are speakers to speak about, but the most common in growing are the CAV, and people do many things to prevent it, including the space, deep litter, and so many others, including vaccination. And with CAV, there is always COXI because it's an immunosuppressive disease. And in layer, we have issues with the LPI, we do vaccines. We have an issue with Marex, we get rid of Marex, it come again. And the most important is the gut health with the necrotic enteritis, which is very common, maybe because of your water quality, or maybe a feed quality, or maybe other stress factor. Economically, people ask, because of last 2 years, we got a very good price, but before that, the years was very bad. Where growing a new bird, replacing the old cull flock, was not viable. Those years, people do start molting. I remember the people first start molting in 93 when Gambora strikes India, where everybody's farm was empty by 30% within 6 months. Because everywhere they attack, 30% bird will die. So what you will do? Then they start thinking about molting. I remember I got a note from Venkis, how can you teach me? I was a sales manager for Gujarat to sell the layer chicks. And he says, how can you teach molting? Because it is a direct competing with our chick sale business. That 30% growth in chick sales they want. Anyway, that's a separate story. So that's where people start thinking about the recycling. It's very economic. We had so many economic scenario studied. But key factor which beside that is the market scenario of eggs and culls. Maybe a replacement flock issue like an outbreak. The poor production due to the viral disease, like if you have an IB or LPI outbreak and production run at less than 80, you can molt. How many minutes? Ah, enough. You can molt and save money or survive the farm. And the most important and the last but not least is the cell quality. If you straighten the flock up to 80 weeks, it's okay, you can maintain cell quality. After that, if you want to improve, you have to cycle. And you can consider like a short molting cycle or a standard California type long molting cycle, depends on the scenario. So those are the short versus standard. And then this also helps is managing your mortality and the lambness. If you do a molting with a very, as per the protocol, and this will help you in a managing uniformity, because while molting, there is a 10 days resting period where you can again make the flock back to the grower stage, very uniform. And that will come to the peak very nicely. Few factors I want to tell, that is a pollution factor, and nowadays those whoever having expansion has to go and get the certificates for this. And these are very important, the litter smell, and either it's a closed house, open house, it's the same. The smell is still there. So that's a number one factor. Second is the fly management. There are various ways you can control the flies. One of the best ways is to maintain the litter dry. Maybe other you can use a larvicidal drugs in a periodic manner. Or a last option is that like leave a water in a litter. So you just drown all the fly larvae and you are getting a fly. But it's very expensive because many people are getting manure price, particularly in Maharashtra region, almost like 2,000 rupees per ton. And one bird produced 20 kg of litter, which is equivalent to a chick cost. It's a big return if you manage the litter. Feeder and flop also to the neighboring fields, also a big concern. And the burning is the only option. How can you control the, and this is also a big issue. It's a big cost when you have a dead bird disposal. How many pits you have if you're having a big farm? How many pits you will have in a farm? The ideal way is to having a furnace and burn, but that also creates again a smell issue and a lot of cost to burn the birds. Most important point we learn in the last 2 years, that before that trader used to stock eggs and get the margin. Now all key layer clients having their own cold storage and making a margin. And I work out the last 3 years economics with the various client. And I found that they cycle eggs 2 to 3 times in a year. Up to 60% of eggs they cycle and don't sell against. Means in a low period they stock, and as soon as get a good period like a 30 days, 45 days, 60 days, or 90 days, they sell. This will really help to earn them 0.5 to 1 rupees after all expenses paid. And 60% eggs for the 310 eggs is almost like 180 eggs. And if I consider 50 paisa, is almost 90 rupees a bird. It's a huge margin. It's very easy to manage those cold store at the 2 degrees centigrade. And even there is no compulsion that you have to run generator, because even after the lights off, the same cold storage can maintain for another 3 to 6 hours without having a power. One exercise, because we have a 10 minutes.
Hello.
10 minutes we have to do this. I just work out, just yesterday I work out those figures for today's economics. My question to you is that just calculate on today's scenario that how viable is the layer project. This is without land cost. And these are the real time figure as on today. All right, so I think I'm done without any remark. Thank you, sir.